Hi guys, and welcome to another episode of Attorney Javier Vlogger, Law for the Everyday Layman. Today we begin with a new series on the Revised Corporation Code under Republic Act Number 11232. This effectively repeals the old Corporation Code under Batas Pambansa Bilang Number 68. Okay? So, I won't be discussing the old law much anymore, no? Except with reference to the new law. More often than not, when I talk about the principles, it will already be in light of the new law, okay? So that there will be less confusion, okay? So if you like my videos and you want to see more, please hit the like button, okay? Also, please remember that this is only for educational purposes and is not a substitute for proper legal advice or for studying and understanding the law. Don't forget to subscribe, okay? Now, shout out to Dane Espiritu and all the other people who have been requesting this series, okay? So, I hope you enjoy this series on the Revised Corporation Code, okay? Now, as I often tell my students, no, everything you need to know or review about the corporation law or any other subject for that matter, no, can be found or reviewed in the definition itself. And the law defines a corporation as an artificial being created by operation of law, having the right of succession and the powers, attributes, and properties expressly authorized by law or incidental to its existence. Okay? Here's also a tip, no? I tell my students that you do not need to memorize after having read something again and again and again. It will be stuck in your memory. Like the definition of corporation, no? I can say it again and again because I've read it so many times, I've said it so many times. Okay? So that will go the same for you. So in the definition itself, we know that a corporation is an artificial being. Okay? So what does that imply? This is how simple it is, no? You just go through the definition, no? It's an artificial being. So meaning it has a separate personality which can be pierced in certain instances. And since it's an artificial being, it's not real, no? But it's given an existence by law, that means that it can only act, not physically, but through its board, okay? The definition also says it's created by operation of law. Therefore, it cannot exist without a law allowing for its formation. And therefore, being a creature of the law, it is subject to the law, okay? A corporation is subject to the law, okay? Which includes the rules on foreign corporations, okay? Foreign equity, etc., okay? And the corporation has certain powers, attributes, and properties, and the right of succession, which cover the latter part of the Revised Corporation Code. Okay? The definition itself gives us the attributes of a corporation, no? First, the attributes of the corporation will be the central topic today. Okay? So the attributes of a corporation are, first, it's an artificial being with a separate and distinct personality. Second, it's created by operation of law. Third, no, it enjoys the right of succession. And fourth, it has the powers, attributes, and properties expressly authorized by law or incidental to its existence. Okay? Take note of those four. Now, let's discuss them one by one. Okay? So, the law says a corporation is an artificial being with a separate personality. This means that the corporation is a legal and juridical person. It has a personality which is separate and distinct from its stockholders or members. Okay, it has a different personality. So therefore, there are certain consequences. First, no, the obligations which a corporation itself incurs, no, are its sole liabilities, no? In other words, the stockholders or the officers are generally not liable for those obligations which a corporation incurs, and vice versa, meaning the corporation is not liable for the individual obligations of its stockholders, okay? The corporation itself is different from the people composing the corporation, okay? Second consequence, a corporation having a separate personality has the right to file cases in its own name. It also has the right to acquire, to possess, and to transfer property. In this case, now when it comes to property, the property belongs to the corporations and not to the stockholders. In other words, let's say the corporation owns a beach house in Boracay. Can the president say, hey, I'm going to use that because I am a stockholder and therefore, since the corporation owns it, I own it as well. Can he say that? No. Okay? The corporation owns that the beach house, okay? And the only interest that that president stockholder has in the beach house is, as of now, an inchoate or undetermined interest. Okay? You can only determine that later on. Okay? So, an individual stockholder or even an officer cannot claim ownership over properties belonging to the corporation because, again, they have separate personalities. Okay? Next, consequence. Jurisdiction may be acquired over the corporation itself by service of summons on the proper representative. We can talk about that later on, and the rules on these are found in civil procedure in remedial law. Okay? Next consequence, a corporation remains unaffected by changes in its individual membership. Okay, this also has relation to the right of succession. We'll talk about that later. Okay, next consequence, a corporation is entitled to certain constitutional rights like due process, equal protection, protection against unlawful searches and seizures, but not all constitutional rights, okay? Because some constitutional rights apply only to natural persons, okay? Just remember due process, equal protection, protection against unlawful search and seizure, okay? Another consequence is that a corporation may be held liable for a tort or quasi-delict committed by its officers, no? Especially under the doctrine of corporate responsibility. This is found in jurisprudence or cases involving liability of hospitals where the hospitals may be held responsible for the negligent acts of its doctors, etc. No? But when it comes to crimes, a corporation may be held liable if there is an express provision of law. Okay? Now, another consequence would be that corporation, since it is not a natural person, since it's an artificial being, generally, a corporation is not entitled to moral damages. Okay? Why? Because moral damages contemplate mental suffering, sleepless nights, okay, which an artificial being cannot suffer. However, in some instances, a corporation may be entitled to moral damages in case its reputation is besmirched, okay? Such as in the case of libel under Article 2219 of the Civil Code. However, of course, there must be proof of damage and the relation to the acts which are complained of, okay? So in sum, there is what we call the principle of limited liability. That by virtue of the separate juridical personality of a corporation, the corporate debt or credit is not the debt or credit of the stockholders. In other words, it's a protection from liability for stockholders, which is one of the biggest contrasting factors against sole proprietorship. Because in a sole proprietorship, the debts of that entity are also the debts of the proprietor. Okay, here there is a sort of a shield or the corporate veil, which we will be talking about now. Okay, now as I said, there is a corporate veil between the corporate entity and the individuals which comprise it. Okay, there is a veil, no? Or there a veil also exists between a parent corporation and a subsidiary. Okay? Meaning, again, this follows the principle that the corporation is an artificial being. Okay? Now, there are instances when that corporate veil may be pierced. Okay? In other words, we see through that corporate fiction, we look through that veil in order to hold those who should be held liable, liable. Okay? We hold them liable because they have used the corporate vehicle for wrong means, no? To achieve a wrongful end, okay? So, in other words, again, piercing the veil is simply looking through or looking past the corporate form to the individual stockholders composing it, okay? The separate juridical personality of the corporation is disregarded, okay? But take note that this remedy of piercing the veil may be only used to prevent fraud or wrong, or to prevent or redress fraud or wrong, and it is essentially a judicial prerogative only, meaning it's only the courts who can pierce the veil, okay? And take note, ha, that this piercing the veil, this is not your first remedy, okay? It is a remedy of last resort, meaning it can only be availed of if the wrong that is committed warrants piercing of the veil, okay? And the wrong which warrants the piercing must be clearly and convincingly established, and it cannot be presumed. You cannot presume na, hey, there's a wrong, let's pierce the veil. No, you have to clearly prove it, okay? Now, let's say the veil is pierced, and we're looking at the individuals who should be held liable, not the corporation, because it's really the individuals. Okay, even if the veil is pierced, there will be no res judicata. Okay, so what do I mean? There's no res judicata. It just means that even if the veil is pierced in one case for one transaction, which is the subject of the case, the corporate, the separate corporate personality, or the corporation will still be presumed to have a separate juridical personality in other cases. It's only for the transaction which is subject of the case that we will take away the corporate veil and hold the people who are responsible liable for the wrong, okay? But for other legitimate purposes, the corporate fiction will still exist, okay? So the rule is that mere ownership by a single stockholder or by another corporation of all or substantially all the capital stock does not justify the application of the remedy of piercing the veil, okay? There must be other circumstances that must be present, which brings us to the classification, no, of piercing the veil cases. So first, we have what are known as fraud cases, which piercing the veil may be availed of, no, when the separate corporate personality is used to justify wrong, to protect fraud or defend crime, or is used as a shield to confuse legitimate issues, in which case the corporation will be considered as a mere association of persons, and the liability now will attach directly to the individual stockholders or the other corporation, okay? So in order for this to exist, no, there are certain elements provided for by law, no, by jurisprudence rather. Okay? First, there must have been fraud or an evil motive, no, in the affected transaction. In other words, mere proof of control of the corporation itself, it will not authorize piercing. Will not authorize piercing. There has to be proof of fraud or an evil motive. Second, the main action should seek enforcement of pecuniary or money claims pertaining to the corporation against corporate officers or stockholders or vice versa. And finally, the corporate entity should have been used in the perpetration of the fraud, okay? Or the justification of a wrong, or to escape personal liability, okay? So, fraud cases, just remember that the corporate entity was used to commit fraud, to justify wrong, okay? In that case, we pierce the veil and we hold the people using that corporate veil to protect themselves. We hold them liable, okay? Now we go to alter ego cases, no? In alter ego cases, now the word's alter ego, no? Here, the corporation is a mere farce, no, or a pretense, no. People are pretending there's a corporation, okay. But in fact, no, they're just using it to gain their own personal ends, okay. The corporation is a mere farce or pretense, since the corporation is merely the alter ego, the business conduit, or an instrumentality of a person or persons or another entity, okay. One of the most common situations for alter ego cases, no, is the parent company and subsidiary company, okay? So first, what's a subsidiary, no? A subsidiary is a corporation more than 50% of the voting stock of which is owned or controlled directly or indirectly through one or more intermediaries by another corporation. Okay? Now, that corporation which it directly or indirectly controls the subsidiary is known as the parent company. Okay? Now, take note, now just because there is a parent and subsidiary relationship does not warrant piercing the veil. Okay? Because the law allows parent companies to create subsidiaries. Okay? That's fine. So, as a general rule, if it is used for legitimate functions, a subsidiary's separate existence, no, will be respected. And the liability of the parent corporation and the subsidiary are their sole responsibilities. Walang problema, okay? Your problem is your problem, your problem is your problem, okay? However, there are factors that may justify piercing the veil between the parent and the subsidiary where they will be considered as one entity, okay? They will be considered as a single entity. And there are several factors. You can read this in your books. I'll just give you some, okay? I won't spoon feed you, no? So, some circumstances, parent company owns all or most of the capital stock. They have both companies have common directors or officers. The parent company finances the subsidiary. The parent subscribes to all the capital stock of the subsidiary or causes its incorporation. The subsidiary has substantially no business except with the parent. The directors of the subsidiary do not act in the interest of the subsidiary, but rather they take orders from the parent, etc. No? There are a lot of circumstances. Okay? Just take note that the remedy of piercing the veil, it's a remedy of last resort. So the mere fact that only one circumstance that I mentioned or that you may read exists, no, just one, that's not enough to, usually it's not enough to warrant piercing the veil, okay? Usually it has to be a concurrence of factors, so we follow the totality of circumstances test, no? The court will examine all the circumstances you have mentioned to see if piercing the veil is warranted, okay? So the best, in order for you, the best situation for you to be able to say, let's pierce the veil, is that there should be a concurrence of at least two or more of these circumstances I mentioned, no? In order for you to justify piercing the corporate veil. Okay, which brings us to the instrumentality or alter ego rule. Okay, so when one corporation is so organized and controlled and its affairs are conducted so that it is in fact a mere instrumentality of the other, then we can disregard the corporate fiction. Okay, so what's the test? First, control. Okay, control, not mere majority or complete stock control, but complete dominion, not only of finances, but of policy and business in respect of the transaction which is attacked. Okay, so that the corporate entity as to the transaction had at that time no separate mind, will, or existence of its own. Halatang ginamit lang siya. Okay, second, that control, no, must have been used by the defendant to commit a fraud or wrong in contravention of the complainant's legal rights. And finally, the control and breach of duty must proximately cause the injury or the unjust loss which is complained of. Okay? Finally, we have the equity or public convenience cases, no? Which is sort of a catch-all situation, no? Sort of lang, okay? So, this is resorted to when piercing the corporate fiction is necessary to achieve justice or equity, or in case there are no circumstances to justify fraud or alter ego cases, no, or when public convenience is defeated, such as when the corporate vehicle is merely used to evade an existing obligation, no? I'm saying, hey, I have a corp, so I won't perform my obligation. Okay, so that may be a ground to warrant piercing the veil. Okay, So what happens when the corporate veil is pierced? Okay? Now, the corporation will be treated merely as an association of persons, and the stockholders or members will be considered as the corporation, meaning that no, the liability now will attach personally and directly to the officers, stockholders, or members that make up the corporation. And in case of two different corporations, again, they will be treated as one entity, with the one being treated as a mere instrumentality, agency, or adjunct of the other, no? So that the real actor shoulders the liability of the instrumentality, okay? But take note that when the corporate veil is pierced, the corporate character is not destroyed, ha? It still continues for other legitimate objectives. It is only pierced for the specific transaction complained of. Okay? Unless, of course, later on, the corporate charter is revoked by the SEC, etc. No? Okay. Now we can move on to the second attribute, namely that a corporation is created by operation of law. Okay? Here in this attribute, we follow the concession theory. Okay? In other words, a corporation comes into existence only on the issuance of the certificate of incorporation from the SEC. After, of course, the corporation, the people applying for incorporation have complied with all the requirements. Okay? So, in other words, unlike partnerships, the corporations cannot be created by mere agreement. Huh? Okay? The partnerships can be created by mere agreement because they are contracts, but not corporations. Because corporations require a special grant from the state, which comes from the legislature. Okay? How does it come from the legislature? Either through a general law. No? And when we talk about the general law, that applies to private corporations. And what's that general law? We have the Revised Corporation Code, no? RA 11232. Okay? The Revised Corporation Code, and previously, no, BP 68. And under the current law, no, we have the primary franchise or the privilege granted by the state to individuals to exist and act as a corporation after its incorporation. And we also have the secondary or special franchise or the privilege, no, conferred on the corporation, okay? On the corporation, not the stockholders, ha? It's conferred on the corporation to the business it was created, no? Such as those issued by the SEC to companies that issue securities, okay? Primary franchise is granted to individuals to create a corp, no? And special is granted to the corporation, okay? So again, private corporations created through the general law, which is the Revised Corporation Code. Now, what about public corporations? No? Public corporations are not created through that general law na Revised Corporation Code. Huh? The public corporations are created through a special law or charter. Okay? Take note that private corporations cannot be created through special laws. Huh? They cannot be created through special laws. Okay? Except for GOCCs. And how do you, GOCCs meaning a government-owned and controlled corporations, no? And how do we know if a corporation is a GOCC? We follow now the case of Liban versus Gordon, which overturned the old test, which I will not mention anymore to avoid confusion. Okay? The test now under Liban versus Gordon is whether or not the government owns or controls it. Okay? So in the case of stock corporations, if the government owns majority of the stock, then it's a GOCC. In case of non-stock corporations, if majority of the members are part of the government, then it's a GOCC. Okay? So in that case of Liban versus Gordon, local water districts are GOCCs because they have no private capital and are controlled by government. Okay? And this case also held that the position of chairman then held by Gordon, no, is not a government office or the office of a GOCC. Why? Because the office of chairman in PNRC, Philippine National Red Cross. Okay? Why? Because the charter of Philippine National Red Cross is void. Why? Because the Red Cross is not controlled nor funded by the government, and therefore its charter is void because Congress cannot create a private corporation through a special law. In other words, the Red Cross was treated as a private corporation. Okay? Because again, the government does not control nor fund it. Okay? Now, so since a corporation is created by operation of law, of course, a corporation, regardless of its kind, is subject to the law and has to follow it. This includes laws on nationality, and we have tests, no, to determine the nationality of a corporation. Namely, first, no, we have the place of incorporation test, no, which simply means that the corporation is a national of the state where the corporation is incorporated, regardless of the nationality of the stockholders. So if it's incorporated here, it's a Philippine corporation. Okay, that's important. We also have the domicile test. We don't follow this, no? Which just states that the corporation is a national of the state where the corporation is domiciled. Okay? And finally, we have the control test or the wartime test, no? Which simply states that the nationality of the controlling stockholders determines the nationality of the corporation. So what test do we use? Okay, here in the Philippines, so we follow the place of incorporation test, okay, to determine the nationality of the corporation. If it's incorporated here, it's a Philippine corporation. If it's incorporated in the States, then it's a U.S. national. Okay, take note, however, no, that while we follow the incorporation test here in the Philippines for investment purposes, okay, for determining compliance with the foreign equity requirement, we apply the control test. We look at the nationality of the controlling stockholders. Okay, take note of that, no? The pertinent law on this matter would be, of course, the Constitution, no, the 60-40 requirement, and also the Foreign Investments Act, specifically the negative list, no? And the latest of that, no, as of the time of this video, no, is EO 65, Executive Order 65, Series of 2018, signed by President Duterte, no, as of the time of this video, no. And this negative list, no, prescribes the necessary percentages of ownership allowed in certain industries, like in the case of mass media, practice of professions, cooperatives, etc. No foreign equity is allowed, meaning foreigners cannot own shares in those industries. But it also provides some industries where foreigners may participate and give certain percentages, no, like 25%, 30%, 40% ownership. And the common one is 60-40, no? 60% Filipino, 40% foreign. Okay, that's common. Just look at the list to know what's what, no? So the rule is we apply the control test in investment purposes and for looking at foreign equity, no? However, sometimes by exception, okay, in order to determine if a corporation has violated the law on foreign ownership, we apply the grandfather rule. Okay, what's the grandfather rule? It's simply a method of determining the nationality of a corporation which is owned by another corporation. How? By breaking down the equity structure of the stockholders. Okay, take note, this is very important because there has been confusion. What do we apply when it comes to foreign equity or participation, no, or ownership, no? Do we apply the control test? Do we apply the grandfather rule? The rule, as stated by the Supreme Court, is that the grandfather rule is merely a supplement. It's a supplement to the control test. Okay, so we apply the control test first. Okay? In order to determine the nationality of a corporation, we apply the control test, and then we only apply the grandfather rule when the ratio of Filipino to foreign ownership is in doubt. Okay? There is doubt as to the Filipino to foreign ownership ratio, or where there is reason to believe that there has been non-compliance with the provisions on the Constitution on the nationality restriction, no? For the sake of convenience, the 60-40 ratio. 60 for Filipinos, 40 for foreigners, okay? And how do you know there is doubt, no? As to the percentage of ownership. There is doubt when the beneficial ownership and control of the corporation, no, do not in fact reside in Filipino stockholders but in foreign stockholders, such as when the foreign investors provide practically all the funds or the technical support and they manage the corporation even though they are the minority stockholders, no? So in applying the grandfather rule, the percentage of shares held by the second corporation in the first, no, is multiplied by the second corporation's own Filipino equity, and the product of that multiplication, okay, is the ultimate Filipino ownership in the subsidiary corporation. Okay, now that may be vague and abstract. I'll give you an example. Okay, so let's say there's Corporation A. Okay. Corporation A wants to engage in an activity where the foreign participation is limited to 40%, meaning dapat 60% si Pinoy. Okay? Let's say it has 1 million shares. Of that 1 million shares, 600,000 of those shares are owned by only two entities. First, 600,000 is owned by Corporation B, and the rest, 400,000, is owned by an American. Okay, so looking at it, it looks like it complies with the law, no? 600,000 is 60% of 1 million, no? And it belongs to Corporation B, which is supposedly Filipino-owned, okay? And on its face, 60-40 complies with the law. There should be no problem, okay? So applying the control test, if Corporation B likewise is owned 60% by Filipinos and 40% by foreigners, let's say Japanese, then that 60% ownership of Filipinos in Corporation B, we apply it now to Corporation A. And the 60% owned by Corporation A is now deemed to be fully Filipino. Okay? Now, when do we apply the grandfather rule? Earlier, we applied the control test, okay? We apply the grandfather rule if the share of the Filipinos in the corporation is less than 60%, no? Because there, in that case, there is doubt, no? As I mentioned earlier. Like, for example, if, remember, Corporation B and the American own shares in Corporation A. Let's talk about Corporation B now. Let's say Corporation B is owned 55% by Japanese and 45% by Filipinos. So in this case, there is clearly doubt, okay? So to determine if Corporation A is a Filipino corporation which complies with the Constitution and the Foreign Investments Act, we have to use the grandfather rule and trace the equity to Corporation B, okay? We trace it to Corporation B. Here, since the Filipinos only own 45% of Corporation B, we multiply that by the 600,000 shares owned by the corporation, owned by Corporation B in Corporation A, to get how much? 270,000 shares, or 27% of equity in Corporation A. Remember, the American has 40%, and if the Filipinos only have 27%, then the Japanese have 33%. Total, all in all, in Corporation A, the total foreign equity is 73%. 40% American, 33% Japanese, 73%. So Corporation A fails the test and violates the Constitution, which may result in the revocation of the corporation. Corporate existence, rather. Okay? Take note also of the case of Gamboa versus Tevez, in that the Constitution explicitly reserves ownership and operation of public utilities to Philippine nationals, meaning corporations at least 60% of whose capital with voting rights belongs to Filipinos. Why do I mention this case, no? Because for stocks to be deemed owned and held by Philippine nationals, mere legal title is not enough. Full beneficial ownership of stocks coupled with voting rights is essential. And capital refers to shares with voting rights as well as full beneficial ownership, because the right to vote directors coupled with full beneficial ownership translates to effective control of a corporation. Take note of that, okay? Now we can move on to the next attribute. A corporation enjoys the right of succession, okay? So a corporation has the potential to be immortal, okay? Especially more so under the revised corporation code. Because in the old law, no, BP 68, no, the old corporation code, a corporation could only exist for 50 years, extendable for another 50 years. Now, a corporation may have perpetual existence. Okay? So it can last forever. Okay? Interesting trivia, no? The oldest corporation still operating in the world is called Congo Gumi, no? It was established in 578 AD in Japan, and it's a construction company specializing in Buddhist temples, okay? So this attribute of succession, no, allows a corporation to manage its own affairs, to hold property without the inconvenience of perpetual conveyance, of transmitting it from one person to another, okay? So which make up the corporation, no? Through this perpetual succession, the artificial person, its identity, and personality remains the same even though there may be frequent changes to its members. In other words, a corporation continues to exist even if there is a change in the people who compose it. If one dies or if he transfers all of his shares, that will not affect the continued existence of the corporation. And finally, we can talk about the last attribute. A corporation has the powers, attributes, and properties expressly authorized by law or incidental to its existence, no? Under Section 44 of the Revised Corporation Code, no corporation shall possess or exercise corporate powers other than those conferred by the Corporation Code or by the Articles of Incorporation, and except as necessary or incidental to the exercise of the powers conferred. Okay? In other words, if the act of the corporation is not one of those express, implied, or incidental powers, then the act is an ultra vires act. Okay? It's voidable, ha? Okay, it is an ultra vires act or one committed outside the object for which a corporation is created as defined in its articles of incorporation and therefore beyond the power conferred by law. Okay, we'll talk more about ultra vires acts when we get to that topic. Okay, just take note that this is a recognition of the theory of special or limited capacities which we follow here. Okay, as contrasted with the theory of general capacities, where it says that a corporation may exercise any and all powers that may be exercised by natural persons, and it has such powers that are not prohibited or withheld from it by law. We do not follow that, ha? I'm just defining it, okay? We follow the theory of special or limited capacities, meaning that the corporation has only such powers expressly granted to it by law, or its articles of incorporation, or incidental to its existence, or implied, no? Okay? So to determine if the corporation has acted correctly under the theory of special capacities, the test is whether the act of a corporation is in direct and immediate furtherance of its business, fairly incidental to the express powers, and reasonably necessary to their exercise. Okay? If so, then the corporation has the power to do it. Otherwise, then it does not. Okay? So that's it for the nature and attributes of a corporation. No? I hope you may have picked up a thing or two, and I hope to see you for the next episode on this series. Okay? See you soon, guys. Bye.